bhunaktu saha viryam karavavahai tejasvinavadhitamastu ma vidvishavahai om shanti shanti shantihi. Gurur Brahma, Gurur Vishnu, Gurur Devo Maheshwarah, Gurur Eva Param Brahma, Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha, Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Sachidananda Rupaya Vishvotpatyadihetave Tapatraya Vinashaya Shri Krishnaya Vayam Numaha Nigamakalpataror Galitam Phalam Shukamukhadam Ratadravasam Yutam Pibata Bhagavatam Rasamalayam Muhuraho rasika bhuvibhavkaha Janmadhyasya yaton vayadi tarataha Charthesva bhignyasvarat Tene brahma hridaya adikavaye Muhyanti yatsurayaha Tejo varimradam yatha vinimayo Yatra trisargo mrusha dhamna svena sada nirasta kuhakam satyam param dhimahi dharma projita kaita votra paramo nirmatsaranam satam vedyam vastava matra vastu shivadam tapatrayon mulanam Srimad Bhagavate Maha Munikrate Kimvaparairishwaraha Sadyo Hridya Varudyate Trakritibhi Sushrushubhistakshanat.
So Rukmini ji sent a Brahmana with a message to Krishna. When she saw that her brother, out of complete hatred towards Krishna, wanted to get his sister married to Shishupala. So there were two reasons why he wanted to get his sister married to Shishupala. One, though Rukmini ji liked Krishna, Rukmini personally did not like Krishna. The second reason why Shishupala is because Shishupala equally shared that interest of Rukmini. And he thought it would be a good team that if they ever set up an army or a force against Krishna, Shishupala and Rukmi would make good team. So the marriage was arranged. Bhishmaka, though was going with the sons, had left it to the Lord that, O Lord, whatever be the suitable one, may that happen to my daughter. So looking at this, at her own situation, Rukmini ji sent a duta, an ambassador, with a very precise message from her to the Lord. So the Brahmana gives that entire message. he speaks in the first person as though it was Rukmini ji herself speaking to Krishna. Shrutva gunan bhuvana sundara shunvatam te. There have been many people who have been visiting our kingdom, our this particular city, Kundinpur. And people have been talking great tales about you. Shrunuvatam, we have been hearing great valor, great details about you. And how are you? And what is the address that she, first word of address, she says, Bhuvana Sundara Shrunvatam Te. This entire Tribhuvana, the three worlds, Sundara, the only one which is worthy of beholding is you, O Lord. And the Drishya, the form of yours, all are Purushartha, whether it is Dharma, Artha, Kama, Moksha, finds its fulfillment only in you. So such, O Mukunda, it is not that I am becoming Dina and, you know, begging of you, but I think, look at the confidence of Rukmini Devi ji. Why not? She was the Sakshat Lakshmi Devi herself. So what was her message? She said, I am not being Dina and Heena to been requesting you, but I think it would be a good match. You are good in Kula, Shila, Swabhava, Saundarya, Vidya, Avastha, Dhana, Sampatti, everything. I think I am a good match to you. She was not like, you know, oh Lord, I beg of you, please come and take me, I'll be waiting. That part is also there. But the first part she says, that I think I am the right match to you. Continuing, she says, I have given my entire heart, mind and this body unto you. Now listen to this very carefully. She's talking to Krishna directly. Okay. Listen to this carefully. If I do not get you as my husband in this life, even if I have to spend the next 100 lives waiting for you as my husband, it will be only you who can be my husband and nobody else can ever be my husband. Before wolves, cheap ones like Sishupala even dare touch me, I would want to be taken by you as his wife. Now if you feel that, you know, there will be so many people who would be coming to our kingdom because Sishupala and Dantavakra, Jarasandha and everybody will be invited, I give you the plan also. She gives a detailed sketch about the entire Nagari. And that particular day, just the day before marriage, it is the Kula Parampara that the girl goes to worship Gauri Devi, Uma Parvati ji's temple. And there is a special route which will be well guarded. But when I am offering my prayers and I am done with my prayers, when I am returning back, that is the time there will be lot of utsava, there will be lot of dance and lot of commotion. That would be the right time for you to, you know, take me away with you. So she not only has a request, but also a plan of action for the Lord to execute. Very thoroughly chalked out. So the Brahmana Devata says, Hey Yaduvamsha Shiromani, Hey Yadudeva, this is the message that I had for you. So the Lord immediately called for his charioteer, Sarathi. The Lord had a huge stable, but he specifically names four horses, the chosen ones, which the Lord trusted. Sacha Ashvaihi. So what are these Ashva? Shaivya, Sugriva, Meghapushpa, Balahaka. These were the four names of the horses. So he called his charioteer Sarathi and said, pick these four horses, yoke them to the chariot, and be here ASAP. He said, Ratham upaniya. This is when? As of now. So the Sarathi runs, gets the chariot with these four horses. Now it's not just the chariot, you know, you're going on a long tour, it seems like. So all the fodder, whatever was required, whatever was the all the arrangements that he grabbed and made the chariot ready. So in that chariot, there was the Brahmana Devata, because he was the one who had come with this message. He had to go back and give this message that, yes, I have spoken to Sri Krishna Bhagavan and Krishna Bhagavan has already come or is waiting for you, whatever was the message. And the best of the four horses were put on use. So Brahmana Devata got inside the chariot. Krishna Bhagavan himself got into the chariot and did not leave a message for anybody else. Now he is the Sarvabhauma, he is the Lord of the entire universe. So he does not need anybody's support if he has taken up some job. He can single-handedly perform it. And the best part to look at it is, when somebody with complete devoted heart calls for the Lord immediately starts working for them. We complain that, you know, we only pray but we never know if our prayers are ever being answered. So there is a famous bhajan. This, in that particular bhajan, they sing, you say that the Lord never eats the prasad that we offer. I said, have you ever given it as Sabari would have given it, with that intensity? The Lord never answers our prayers. Have you called with the intensity of Draupadi? Have you gone with the intensity of a friend like Sudama had gone? Have you gone with the intensity of Arjuna who sought real help from the Lord? So when we do our devoted effort, the Lord immediately jumps into action. But it seems like Lord has gone jobless. Not because of a recession. He seems to have gone jobless for centuries now, for eons. Even our dhyana shloka, how do we remember the Lord? He is on the ananta. And what is he doing on that ananta? Yoga nidram asan. He is constantly in yoga nidra. Because he has been waiting and waiting and waiting. Some devotee might call sometimes. But his waiting has turned into yoga nidra. Nobody calls him now. Look at Rukmini ji called and he immediately jumped into his chariot. Did not bother informing anybody else there. He just left. And he left to the next city with such speed. Because this Brahmana Devata had come in the evening. By the early hours in the morning of the next day, Krishna Bhagavan's chariot was already in Vidarbha Desha, in Kundinpur. Now in Kundinpur, it was a very funny situation. Bhishmaka, father of Rukmini ji, whoever was the guest who had come in, he would step right into the front, invite them, give them the, you know, every king had a status, yathochita, with whatever status that they deserved. Better than that, they had made arrangements. So he would go invite them, give them those arrangements, do satkara, sammana, puja, give them orders to the, all the servants as to how to take care of them. All said and done, he was the bride's father and the responsibility was too huge. So he was shocked. He was shocked to see Krishna Bhagavan rich. So he thought, maybe he is related to Shishupala. So Shishupala might have said, you know, you also come and join. So that's what Bhishmaka thought. Shishupala thought that maybe it was not Rukmi but Bhishmaka called Krishna. So with so many people who had gathered, nobody actually knew who invited Krishna. It does happen sometimes, you know, when you go into a marriage wherein you know both sides, and both sides think that you are representing their side. So Krishna was given a very beautiful place. And Bhishmaka did not ask him, you know, what about your entourage or, you know, where are your other people? He kept quiet. Krishna also kept quiet. Pretty soon, to be joined by Balaramji, because Balaramji had gotten this information from Kundinpur spies that all these rajas and atithis of Rukmi had gathered there, guessing that Krishna would do some prank. So they have come with their sainya, Akshohini, Chaturangi sainya. You know, people on horses, on elephants, on chariots, on foot. And they had actually camped entire space around this Kundinpur. So Balaramji, you know, the guest that, you know, Krishna is up to something. And he was the older brother. So he immediately arranged for one Akshohini sainya, divided into various parts. Just few hours after Krishna had reached Kundinpur, Balaramji also arrived. So he was also invited, taken to the place where Krishna was. So though they were surprised seeing each other, Balaramji looked at Krishna and said, everything is under control. I've just come to support you. Now, let's go to the other side. This is all the invitations and Bhishmaka in the palace when all guests were housed. Now, poor Rukmini did not get any information from either Krishna or that Brahmana. That day was the Gauri Puja. Next day was marriage. With lot of apprehension, with lot of, you know, her mind was not in one direction. So she was woken up early in the morning and she was decorated very beautifully. In fact, she herself was Lakshmi Devi and she was looking beautiful as such. But she was given Chandana Snana, then the, you know, milk. She was bathed with milk, then she was given various kinds of snana, and then she was beautifully decorated with all the vastra, abhushana, alankara just done. It was looking as though that, you know, Lakshmi Devi herself was sitting. You know, why not? Because it was Lakshmi Devi herself sitting, it was not just looking. She was herself Lakshmi Devi ji. And she took the puja thali. And it was the tradition that they performed the Shodashopachara Puja to Gauri Devi that day. So she took the entire thali, reached to the temple gates, cleaned herself up, you know, hands, feet, and went inside and started performing puja. As she was walking this entire path, her mind was constantly thinking as to where could this have gone wrong? Why did Lord Krishna not arrive? Why was there not even a message that was sent to her? There's something that was bothering her. Her heart was throbbing in apprehension. Her eyes had almost swelled with tears in anticipation that what would happen if Lord would not arrive. She did not want to go with Shishupala. She did not want to get even touched by any other person, even in her imagination. But with a lot of courage, she pulled herself, went into the temple, performing the Shodashopachara puja. As she performed this entire puja, guided by the old Brahmani ladies who were there inside helping Rukmini Deviji, her left thigh, left shoulder, left eye started throbbing. You know, they say that for women, when the left eye throbs, it is not the flickering of the eye, but there is a different pulsating feeling. It is a Shubha Shuchana for the women. For the men, it has to be the right side. And when she saw that her left eye was flickering, she said, you know, I was just cursing myself that, you know, I was not that great Bhagyavan. Imagine, if Lakshmiji herself thinks that she is not Bhagyavan, who would have Bhagya then? And she lifted her head. It was also that, you know, so many kings and so many people who were watching her, she was on the spotlight. So her head was down, she would not, you know, lift her head. With the corner of her eye, she just scanned that area, she found the Brahmana standing. So she sent her, ladies who were helping her, she sent one of them to pick that Brahmana and bring him inside the temple. So the Brahmana Deva says, see, the one beautiful thing when you look at these messages, both Rukmini Deviji's message as well as this Brahmana's message back to Rukmini Ji are so crisp, precise, without any ambiguity. So what is the first thing that the Brahmana says? This comes in the 30th shloka of 53rd chapter. Tasya avedayat praptam shasam sayadunandanam uktam cha satya vachanam atmopanayanam prati. So he says, Krishna Bhagavan is here after listening to your words. Tamagatam samagnyaya. So he says, and he has come to fulfill your pratignya of marrying him. To fulfill your pratignya, he has come here. This is the words that he has asked me to tell you. Tam agatam samagnyaya, having understood that Lord of her heart was present, she was, and she knew the, according to her plan, that was the moment that she was waiting for. So she turned other side trying to scan, and there in the distance she saw Krishna Bhagavan's, you know, because she had heard so many things about Krishna Bhagavan's Leela and his Swarupa Varnana that she matched that, you know, the with such attraction could have been none other than Krishna alone. So with her scanned view, she saw there was Krishna. There was full beaming face on her. She was smiling all through. So she turned to this Brahmana. She turned to this Brahmana and said, you know, Brahmana usually are not with the Lolupa. They are not somebody who is after wealth. You know, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, they can be after wealth. But Brahmana usually are happy with lot of blessings, a lot of vidya. And both at this time, she was not somebody who could have blessed him. So she looked, she wanted to give something really good, but she didn't have anything that she could share. So she finally did namaskara to his feet. Did lot of namaskars to that Brahmana and thanked him for his help. And she turned around. Now that particular spot in which her plan, she said that he could come with his chariot to pick her up, was not too far away. So she started planning meticulously her walk. And how was her walk? You know, today's world, they say, there is a, what walk is this? Catwalk. fact, there was a Mahatma, he said this catwalk word is a very, bhikari ka walk. And that is what he would say. Our shastras, when you look into our scriptures, they describe gajagamini with the walk gait of a elephant, or hamsa chalini, the walk of a swan. So here she was walking as a swan, very slowly, meticulously she was walking. In fact, her beauty was so attractive that people who were watching her for the first time saw, though they had seen her so many times, for the first time they saw such beauty that their minds could not grasp. They swooned and fell down, many people. So as she kept walking, Krishna Bhagavan in his chariot with the Garuda as his symbol stepped onto his chariot and suddenly raced into that pathway, and that was well guarded by people from like Jarasandha, Shishupala's brother Dantavakra, Shaila. There were many kings who were guarding that path, because Rukmi had made it very sure that Krishna should not be anywhere around here. But Krishna made such a swift movement. So Rukmini ji was about to get in to the chariot. And she was climbing onto a running chariot. Lord Krishna grabbed her hand and pulled her in. Before anybody could understand what happened, see, those paths were, though mud paths, they were well watered. But in spite, that is how the description, in spite of being watered, the speed with which the Lord came in, there was dust all over. And by the time the dust could settle and people could understand what has happened, they could see the dust moving somewhere far away. It was that brisk, that speed with which the Lord had taken Rukmini Devi ji. By the time they realized, all these kings, they all, we were ready, we knew that there would be something like this happening, but look at that swiftness. They were actually praising Krishna with what swiftness he took Rukmini Devi ji. Now Jarasandha and all these kings who were standing there, they said, shame on us. So by this time, Rukmi and the rest of them gathered around and said, let us chase Krishna. So Rukmi, the oldest of the brothers, made a vow. He took a oath. Now Kshatriyas, we will see even in Mahabharata, whether necessary or not necessary, taking a vow, unnecessary vows. So Rukmi also makes an unnecessary oath here. If that Durta, Krishna, is not insulted, if I don't bring Rukmini back, I will never step into this city again. See, sometimes you may have the strength, but because you have taken a wrong oath, there are tathastu devatas. And you take a wrong vow, then they say tathastu. What you are supposed to do good, you end up doing bad. There was no such goodness in Rukmi here. And look at it from the brother's standpoint. Yes, he wanted to save Rukmini. But if he was a really good brother, he should have asked Rukmini, what was her desire of her heart? Being in the Kshatriya Kula, there was never a forced marriage system. Either the girl chose Swayamvara, or she gave that opportunity to the parents and the older brothers, well-wishers, saying that please search one for me. Here it was, forced almost, that she was never asked even. So this Rukmi took on his kavacha, kunda, everything that he had. jumped into the chariot and drove it himself so fast that in spite of having swift horses, Rukmi's rage drove those horses of his chariot and he stopped Krishna. Now the others followed slowly, but Rukmi went ahead. So the Lord was alone with Rukmini ji and Rukmi had stopped. So what did Rukmi do? So Rukmi took, you know, 4 or 5 arrows at one time and started shooting, raining them towards the Lord. And Rukmini Devi ji, who was scared, looking at all the entire sainya led by Jarasandha and the others who were kings there, and Krishna was all alone. So she got for a moment very scared. First Lord gave some courage to Rukmini ji. He said, don't worry about it. As he was just finishing his sentence, he saw Balaram ji with his force come and cover up his side. So it was like an equal match. So Balaram ji and Krishna Bhagavan communicated through their eyes. So Balaram ji and with his Akshohini Sainya, he took care of the entire rest of the army that was chasing. But between Krishna and Rukmi, there was a little war. He kept shooting arrows. One after the other, the Lord kept destroying the bows of Rukmi. Finally, when Rukmi turned to his sword, the Lord very swiftly, the picture that it is, they both were parallelly, the chariots were running. And while the chariots were running, they were fighting with each other. The Lord ordered his chariot to be such swiftly turned that Rukmi was taken by surprise. In a moment he saw Lord there, in the second moment he saw Lord in his own chariot with a sword drawn. So Rukmini from her chariot shouts, screams, you know, after all he is my brother, please don't harm him. So he turns, gives a smile and says, I'm not going to harm him. But what he has done, he will be insulted. So there was half mustache was shaved, half head was shaved, and his hands and legs were tied to his own chariot. By this time, the other sainya was destroyed by Balaram ji. He turned around and he saw that Rukmi was tied down as a bali pashu. So Balaram ji was playing now the older brother. He looked at Krishna. This is bad. Shyalam tava, I mean, he is your brother-in-law. And your brother-in-law cannot be mistreated like this. Because Rukmini ji was also feeling very bad that her brother was being mistreated. So the Balaram ji gives this message to Rukmini ji. And all the disturbance in Rukmini ji's heart kept going away. Krishna, though wanted to say something at that moment, kept quiet. He said, you know, this is one time that Balaram ji has spoken something, then let him speak. He didn't contest, he didn't argue, he just let it go. And now these three joined, came back to Dwaraka Nagari. And in Dwaraka Nagari, there was the entire Dwaraka Nagari was so excited that the Lord had come back with Rukmini Devi ji. From now on, you can start counting, okay? It is a spree of marriages. So the first marriage that he came with Rukmini Devi ji. And after having come to Dwaraka Nagari, he ordered the entire Brahmanas there to do the Shastra Vidhivat Puja. so that he could do the panigrahana of Rukmini Deviji. The entire Dwaraka Nagari was so ecstatic, and they came out with their best. There was no necessity for any amantrana. Krishna were their own, and they were like, you know, even if Krishna doesn't invite, we don't care. We are going to be a part because that is our marriage, like, you know, our own Krishna's marriage. How can we be not a part of it? So the entire Dwaraka Nagari was there, and the marriage went off with such great pomp and show. Now, after having come back to Dwaraka Nagari and settled down, what happened to Rukmi? Now, Rukmi, he was already insulted, and his ego was bruised, and he couldn't go back because of his own oath. So right at that place where he was caught, he was tied down, he created another new city, which was called Bhojakatakam. Chakre Bhojakatam Nama Nivasaya Mahatpuram Ahatva Durmatim Krishnam Apratyuha Yaviyasim. He says, I am not going to Kundinam, Kundinpura, I am not going back, because I still have my oath to take revenge with this Krishna. Durmatim Krishnam. Now look at the audacity of Rukmi, that he would call Krishna as Durmati. So he stayed back and created another city for himself, whereas Krishna settled with Rukminiji. So it became a legend. It became a legend that, you know, people would often quote this particular incident of Rukmini Devi and Krishna, and there were many folklore that were sung on this particular episode. It, you know, there's a very romantic touch. So there were many poets who had sung on this particular aspect. With Rukminiji, this comes in the next chapter, 55th chapter. Rukminiji very soon had the Garbhadhana, and there was a Shishu growing. She gave birth to Pradyumna. Pretty soon, she gave birth to Pradyumna, first of the sons. This Pradyumna, there is a little story. Who is this Pradyumna, the first son of Rukminiji? As I said, Kamastu Vasudevamshah Dagdah Prag Rudramanyuna. Kamaha, you know, Kamadeva was killed by Dagdha. He was destroyed completely by Rudra when he opened his third eye. So his wife Rati Devi had begged, had asked Rudra Bhagavan, you know, it was actually helping you and Parvati ji to get closer, and how come my husband gets destroyed in between? This is unfair. So I want my pati bhiksha again. He said, not now, but in the dwapara yuga, you will have your husband be reborn as the Amsha of Vasudeva. So that Kamadeva was born as Pradyumna. So this Pradyumna, he was just 10 days old. As the father, so the son. In fact, the son breaks the record of the father. When was the first asura dealt by Krishna himself? It was 3 to 5 months old. Pradyumna broke the record when he was 10 days old. He was abducted by Shambara Asura. Now what did this Shambara Asura do? He had a vision. Somebody who was a witch who gave him this vision, saying that the son, the first son of Krishna, will kill you. So because he had this vision, as soon as this Pradyumna was born, Shambharasura kidnapped him, and on his way back to his place, he threw this small kid into the samudra. And it seems such a typical melodramatic story with such so many twists. Even actually this particular part of Pradyumna Janma and Shambharasura Vadha, there have been many episodes, many people who have written in their own poetic way. So they find that this kid, this child who was dropped into the ocean, got swallowed by a big fish. And this big fish was caught by the fisher folk belonging to the Shambharasura's kingdom. And this was a really huge, unusual fish. So they gifted this to Shambharasura. This is what he wanted to get rid of it. He came back to his own palace in the form of a fish. Now when the cooks were cutting this fish open, they opened this fish and they found this kid in the womb of that fish. There was another lady cook, a helping aid. Her name was Mayavati. This Mayavati is Rati Devi, who was waiting on the instructions of Narada. So she saw this child, and she was told that her husband would come. And she was seeing a small child. They said, is this my husband, or I have to wait for somebody else who has to come? So Naradji again reappears. He says, this is the child, and because of such, you have gone through certain mayavi techniques, you have learnt, you have to reuse them to have your husband grow back exponentially. So she uses all those techniques, and within few days Pradyumna becomes an adult. A young child of 10 days old within few days has become an adult. And under the rigorous training of Mayavati, she trains Pradyumna to be a warrior. And she also teaches him something called Mahamaya Vidya, with which any kind of maya, any kind of illusion applied, this Mahamaya Vidya would be the counteracting, nullifying all the effects of maya. So thus now, completely trained Pradyumna suddenly finds that after the training is done, that this Mayavati's attitude towards him has suddenly changed. So he is confused. He is confused, and he says, I look up to you as a well-wisher, somebody who is older than me, and now you are behaving as though you are my wife. I am totally confused, and this is something unusual. So she takes her original form as Rati Devi, and she narrates the entire story of the earlier life. She narrates the entire story of this particular life when he was born as a son of Krishna. How many? Just a month ago. He was born as the son of Krishna. Bhavan Narayana Sutaha. You are Narayana's son. And you were in the earlier life called as Kamadeva. Kamo Bhavan Prabho. And I was your wife. Because of my prayers, Lord Shiva had given this boon that I nourish you and get you back as my husband. Thus hearing this story, Naradji coming and helping them, they get back married. And now she says, go challenge Shambharasura for a fight. So Pradyumna goes to Prabhashyaivam dadau vidyam Pradyumnaya mahatmane Mayavati mahamayam sarvamaya vinashinim. Mahamaya vidya was now coming handy. He went and challenged that Shambharasura. The Shambharasura, listening to this Kathoravani of Pradyumna, he was challenged. He came out running with his gada and gave it with such a force shooting at Pradyumna that he thought he would be dead. Before even he could see the result, he turned back to his fort. But then he saw that Pradyumna was challenging again. For him, it felt that, you know, his one prahara, that Pradyumna should be done with. So he used all his mayavi shakti on this Pradyumna, but did not work. Now when it was Pradyumna's turn, he took the bow and arrow, shot, you know, the arrows in such a way that it rained on this Shambharasura, and he immediately vanished. And vanished in the sky. From there he started raining all Astra Shastra on Pradyumna. So he invoked this Mahamaya Vidya, wherein all the Maya Shakti of this Shambharasura was destroyed. And he killed the Shambharasura. Now immediately, Mayavati Rati Devi, she reminds, remember, though you have grown to be an adult, for your mother, for your parents, you are still a small little baby. They are searching for you. The entire Dwarakapuri is in shokavastha because of your absence. So it would not be good on our part to delay even a bit. So let us immediately go, fly back. So Pradyumnaji immediately taking Rati Devi, immediately flew back. You know, they had udan kathola. they flew back to Dwarka Nagari. Now in Dwarka Nagari, everybody was confused. Now how are these two, Rati Devi and Krishna Bhagavan? It appeared as though there was a dark cloud filled with lightning. See, this description, most times in India, I never got a good glimpse or a picture, idea. After coming to Dallas, I have had enough such pictures, you know, vivid pictures, wherein dark clouds and there is a streak of lightning. Because Rati Devi was so beautiful and white in complexion, whereas Pradyumna, born to Krishna, he was dark in color. And people were shocked because he appeared very similar to Krishna. The way he walked, the way he talked, the way he smiled, the way his, you know, curly hairs, he looked like Krishna himself. So when they approached, but Rukmini Devi was the first one to understand that this who is coming, who is like Krishna, is my own son. And she hugged this Pradyumna. By this time, you know, Devaki, Vasudeva, Bhagavan Krishna, Balarama, and all the other women, Ugrasena, everybody came down. And they had a formal wedding. They had already married once. A formal Shastrokta marriage was re-performed for Pradyumna and Rati Devi. And they were happy to have their son back. Now in the 56th chapter, there is another episode that happens. There are many stories based on this particular episode. They say that on the Ganesh Chaturthi day, you should not see the moon. So if you see the moon on that day, because Krishna saw that moon, so whoever sees the moon on that day will get apaninda. See, there is khyati, there is ninda, there is apaninda. What does apaninda mean? You are blamed for something which you have not committed. So it so happened that in Dwaraka Nagari, there was this great soldier called Satrajita. This Satrajita was a pious man who was a great devotee of Lord Surya, Bhagavan Surya. Lord Surya was so happy with him that he gave this Satrajita Shyamantaka money. What was the greatness of this money? This money gave, they say, Ashtabharam, 8 bhara. Bhara is a quantity, like we say kilos and pounds today. Bhara was something which quantified. So there is a shloka which describes as to how much. Today we still use the tula, right, for calculating gold. So this you can say, how many tulas? 20 tulas is 1 bhara. So 20 tulas is 1 bhara. So 20 tulas is how many kilos? Any idea? 10 grams, roughly 10 grams, 1 tula. So 20 tulas is 1 bhara. So how many? 200 grams. Ashta bhara, like approximately 1.5 kilos. So this Shyamantaka mani gave 1.5 kilos of gold every single day. Wish, right? I have given you the key also. Who gives this Shyamantaka mani? Lord Surya himself. So do worship of Surya, you will get Shyamantaka mani. So that you can have 1.5 kilos of gold. But remember, that Shyamantaka mani, right from its beginning till the end, problem oh problem. So after getting this from the Surya Bhagavan, Satrajita walked back to Dwaraka Nagari. As he walked into Dwaraka Nagari, he was so radiating, people thought it was Surya Bhagavan in that form who was walking into Dwaraka Nagari. And by this time it was no surprise, they had seen various forms of gods. Varuna, Yama, Indra, many people had come and gone to Dwaraka Nagari. So they said, Surya's turn now to come and visit Krishna. So they ran up to Krishna Bhagavan and said, Surya has come to meet you. Surya? So he took out his PDA and checked. I don't have any appointments. See, he walked out of his palace. And I said, oh, he is not Surya, he is Surya Bhakta. He is Satrajita. So he saw this, you know, beautiful Shyamantaka mani and looked at this Satrajita. He said, you know, it is good that you have been blessed with this Shyamantaka mani, but such a beautiful mani which gives almost 1.5 kilos of gold every single day should be the national property rather than an individual's property. Because once you give this to the nation, it will take care of so many things. It will be such a good resource and a protection for the entire Dwaraka Nagari. So why don't you hand this over to Ugrasena Raja? It was just a mere suggestion. But Satrajita didn't agree. It was just given to him and he had not even enjoyed having that beautiful money. And before he could enjoy it, somebody says, you know, go give it to somebody else. He was a pious man, but he was not such big dani. So once what happened, the brother of Satrajita, Prasena, he requested his brother and he wore that particular Shyamantaka mani in his neck and went for hunting. See, if you are visiting in the town, you would require some ornaments. In the forest, who would be there to see your Shyamantaka mani? A bad choice. And while being hunted, when while he was trying to hunt, he became the hunted. You know, there is an old Hindi song, Shikar Kudiya. Shikar ho gaya. He was killed by a lion. Because the lion was amused with this Samantakamani. Instead of eating that prasena, it snatched this Samantakamani. This lion was further killed by Jambavan himself. Which Jambavan? The same old Jambavan. He was there when Vaman Avatar was there. He had taken 7 pradakshinas of the entire Bhugola. Because 1 feet of the Lord was on the earth, and he had taken pradakshina of that feet 7 times in the Treta Yuga. No, sorry, it was in the Satya Yuga. In Treta Yuga, he helped Rama because he had joined forces with the Vanara Sainya. Now in Dwapara Yuga, Yuga Yugantara he is living on. He kills this lion, snatches this Samantakamani and gives it to his child to play. Such beautiful Samantakamani became a child's play ornament. Now while this story of Prasena and this thing continues, so we cut the story there, come back to Dwaraka. So there is a rumor. They say Krishna asked for it. And seeing that Prasena has taken it, probably Prasena was killed by Krishna and he snatched that Samantakamani. This information reached to Krishna. He said, you know, ABMM, you know what ABMM means, right? Aval Mujemar. Why should I have opened my mouth unnecessarily to that Satrajita stating that he should give this as a national treasure? When he would have faced situations, he would have brought it back. And Lord knew what was the entire story. But now he had to prove it to the entire people. So he picked few, you know, Satyaki, and there were few handful of people that he trusted. He said, let's go hunt down this Samantakamani. So they went on a trail. They found that Prasena was killed by a lion. And they followed the trails of the lion, only to find the lion's dead body. No Samantakamani. And they followed the trail from there because there was a trail left by Jambavan. And there was a big cave, dark cave. So he asked the rest of them to sit outside. And he entered into this cave. And Jambavan became so angry that somebody intruded into his space. There was a Bhishana Yuddha between Jambavan and Krishna Bhagavan. And they threw all the Ayudha, Astra, Shastra. When everything was done, they started throwing stones at each other. When stones were done, they started throwing trees at each other. When everything was done, then they got down to the battle, and the duel, wrestling. And the first move in that wrestling, when Jambavan was kicked aside, he remembered, there's only one person in this entire universe who could use this move to kick me aside. And he immediately fell at his feet. I said, I recognize these feet. These were the same feet of Lord Sri Rama. And I am very sure that you are none other than that great Vishnu who has come in the form of Krishna. So Lord Krishna gave him a bear hug. Literally. And this old devotee of the Lord met his Lord after so many years of gap. So he went into the interiors of his caves, brought this Samantakamani, gave it back to the Lord, and also said, O Lord, this money you can keep, but I have much more valuable money which I would want you to take home. There was a daughter of Jambavan. Her name was Jambavati. So she was given in marriage to Lord Krishna. Rukmini ji, not Jambavati. So he came back with the Shamantakamani and Jambavati. Now let's cut the scene here, let's go back. What happened to these people who were waiting outside the cave? For so many days at length, when they did not find Krishna coming back and not even a sound that they could hear, they got scared. They ran back to Dwarka. And they all, you know, near this guha, there was one Durga Devi's temple. At this Durga Devi's temple, they started worshipping. They just had started. And from the cave emerged Krishna with Shamantakamani and Jambavati. And everybody were very happy looking at Jambavati ji and Krishna with this Shamantakamani. He narrated the entire story. The story is not yet done. Now the Shamantakamani was with him, Jambavati Devi was here, so he gave that Shamantakamani to Satrajita. He said, please have it. Now Satrajita was feeling so bad that he has accused the Lord, and Lord had to go through so much of pain. So he said, you know, keep this Shamantakamani. And along with that Shamantakamani, I am ready to give another money to you. So he had a daughter. Satrajita's daughter's name was Satyabhama. They said, you know, please marry my daughter also. What one Shamantakamani, the line of wives that Krishna Bhagavan had to marry. So he got married to Satrajita's daughter, Satyabhama. He got married to Jambavan's daughter, Jambavati Devi. But then, he now started thinking, if I do accept this Shamantakamani, I've just gotten married and my entire married life will be upside down, topsy-turvy. Do I give this Shamantakamani to Rukmini Devi because she is the first wife that I have married? Or do I give this to Jambavati because her father was the one who finally gave it to me? Or gift this to Satyabhama because her father originally owned it. So he said, you know, if I have this thing along with me, probably the problem will continue. So he very intelligently gave it back to Satrajita. He said, you have been worshipping Surya and this is a gift from Surya. So you keep and you worship this Shamantakamani daily. But the Ashtabhara of gold that you get, you deposit daily into the treasury. So you have the cause, I'll have the effect. So Satrajita was also feeling less guilty with this decision. And Lord Krishna felt relieved not having that Shamantakamani around him anymore. So he gave away that Shamantakamani. Now here, you know, the story of Dwarka, we suddenly move to Hastinapur. What happened in Hastinapur? There was a Agni Kanda, there was a fire mishap. There was a huge building which caught on fire. If the building caught on fire, it was not a big issue. But that building consumed Kunti Devi and her 5 sons. They were assumed to be killed, burnt in that fire. Now if you want to see how Lakshagriha, you don't need to go anywhere. These houses that we live in here in US are no better than Lakshagraha. Any little fire, book, done. Lakshagraha means houses built of wax. It's a special kind of wax. So Krishna, along with Balramji and some of his confident people, left for Hastinapura. Though Bhagavan Krishna knew that Kunti Devi and her five sons were still alive, but he had to play it along. Bhishmam krupam saviduram gandharim dronameva cha tulya dukhau chak sangamya ha kashtami ho chutaha. He also went along with everybody crying, you know, hi, Kunti Devi with her five sons, her dad, you know, ayo, yo, 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 yo. So he also cried along. And then, what happened while Krishna was absent? Here, Akrura and Krutavarma got into a very low scheme. So what did they do? So they went to a person called Shatadhanva. And this Shatadhanva was instigated. He said, both Krutavarma and Akrura, they went to Shatadhanva and said, why don't you snatch away this money, Shamantaka money, from Satrajita? Satrajita had promised you his daughter in marriage, but look, finally he gave the benefits of that Shamantaka money and his daughter to Krishna. So, why don't you go and snatch it from Satrajita? Being instigated thus, Shatadhanva one night went into Satrajita's house. He was sleeping, killed him, and snatched the Shamantaka money. Satyabhamaji, knowing that her father was killed, murdered, embalmed her father, and because Lord Krishna was not available, he was in Hastinapura. She goes to Hastinapura to talk to Krishna and bring him back. She personally goes and brings Krishna back. Now Krishna, understanding that his father-in-law was killed by Shatadhanva, he and Balarama try to trace and chase this Shatadhanva. They chase him all the way to Mithilanagara, Janakapuri. In the outskirts of Mithilanagari, Shatadhanva was caught and he was killed. But they did not find this Shamantaka money. So the Lord looked at Balaramji and said, you know, we probably should go back to Dwaraka. So Balaramji, by this time, he said, you know, I think I will pay my respects to Janakapuri, talk to Janaka, because all these kings who were ruling Mithilanagara were called Janaka. So I'll go meet him personally and stay here probably for a while. So Krishna comes back and then calls for Akrurji. He knew, and the day that they knew that Shatadhanva had ran into both Krutavarma and Akrura, and both knowing that Lord Krishna and Balarama were behind, trying to trace the killer of Satrajita, these two had fled from Dwaraka Nagari. So they traced Akrurji, finally brought him back, and they found that before Shatadhanva ran away, he threw this Shamantaka money into his Akrurji's house. It was still hanging in Akrurji's house. So this Shamantaka money seems to have, it is now understand that with wealth always comes a problem. Those who don't have wealth, are pretty much happy are more happier than those who do not have wealth. Even Lord had to run through all this. And who is Lord? He is Shripati. So when we do pray, pray for something nice. Pray for something which is beneficial both for you and for the society, rather than praying for such white elephants like Samantakamani. So Akrurji was feeling so bad that whatever he had done as instigation. So Akrurji was, said, as a punishment, you keep holding on to this Samantakamani. But the benefits of this Samantakamani keep depositing in the treasury. And thus being punished by the second time, the Samantakamani and its Kalanka, Krishna Bhagavan, you know, finally got rid of that Samantakamani Shapa. Now comes the great description of all various marriages that Lord Krishna had gone through. What we have heard is just three marriages so far. You know, Lord Krishna had 16,108 wives. Don't ask me, how could he marry that many? My only answer is, don't feel jealous. Only he can handle. And do not understand that his marriages, Lord's marriages, are to be understood at the same wavelength as a human marriage. It's the final culmination of the jiva with the Paramatma. And when he has come down into this world, he gave as many people mukti as possible. Various sadhus and, you know, great rishis who had been doing tapascharya, who had taken forms as various gopis, various wives, he had given them mukti by arranging for all these marriages. But of all these various wives that Lord Krishna had, we probably misunderstand and mistake. Even a Hindu probably would say that Krishna married 16,000 gopis. That is something that we can stand correct. Lord Krishna did not marry those gopis at all. In fact, he left Vrindavan, he did not turn back again. So who are these 16,000? So that 16,000 people and the marriages with them is because of an asura called Bhauma Asura. Now who is this Bhauma Asura? Bhaumasura was born to Bhudevi. And when this Bhaumasura's torture was going beyond a certain limit, his plan was, there was a tantric who had given a message to Bhaumasura that if he had sacrificed 100,000 virgin women, he would be Ajaya, he would be invincible. He had already gathered 16,000 women. And these 16,000 women, this Bhaumasura's capital was what today we call as Nagaland, Manipur, Mizoram, and that far east. So he had captured these many women. They sent another Brahmana to Krishna with a message to rescue them. So listening to this, both Krishna Bhagavan and Balaramji took their chariots and went far east in search of this Bhaumasura. Now while they were leaving, Satyabhamaji, she said she would accompany Lord Krishna. Why Satyabhamaji would have to accompany Lord Krishna? Satyabhamaji was like Rukmini Devi, was Lakshmi Devi herself, and Lord Narayana has two wives, right? One is Lakshmi Devi, the other one is Bhu Devi. Rukmini Devi is Lakshmi Devi and Satyabhama is Bhu Devi. He said, you are going to fight against your own son, Bhaumasura. But I had given him a vara that until it crosses a certain limit, he shall not die. So I should be there with you to tell when he crosses that limit. So when Lord Krishna attacked, followed this Bhaumasura, engaged him in his war. At one point, Satyabhamaji asked Krishna, why are you taking so much of, you know, fight with him? Why don't you put this to an end? Krishna was waiting for that moment. He just sent his most powerful arrow into that Bhaumasura. He falls down only to be consumed back into earth. This Bhaumasura had a son. His name was Bhagadatta. So Bhagadatta falls on the feet of the Lord and says, whatever my dad was doing, I totally am not a part of it, and actually I am a devotee of you and I seek your refuge. So Bhagadatta was given that entire kingdom. And look at Lord Krishna. His entire life, he was only a king maker and never became a king himself. So he reinstalled Bhagadatta and crowned him. And these 16,000 women were let free. All these 16,000 women were from that area. So when they were let free, they said, you know, who will accept us? Now, we were in captivity by this Bhaumasura. Now, our parents will not accept us and nobody will marry us. So Krishna Bhagavan looked at Balramji. He said, with your permission, as if he waited for anybody's permission. With your permission, may I accept all these 16,000 women and give them the status of a queen in Dwaraka. So these 16,000 women were sent to Dwaraka Nagari as the queens, as the wives of Bhagavan Sri Krishna. We are not yet done with his list of marriages. There are five more. We'll come to that. Sri Krishna. We'll see that tomorrow. Om Purnamadaha. Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.